Before I talk about the book, Rural America's Pathways to College and Career, I can't tell you how, where's my wife, how sick she is of hearing about the book. After today, it will no longer be dear the book, I promise. So after our first speakers have an opportunity to share their remarks, and the order will be Sherry Brannick. And Sherry is the superintendent of schools at Crown Point Central School, just 29 miles south of here. Sherry, was, did it seem like 29 miles when you drove up this morning?
Snowing.
It was 39 miles this morning. Great schools are, no surprise, all about great leadership. And Sherry Brannick, again, the Crown Point superintendent, is one of the great rural educational leaders in the United States. Sherry, thank you for being here this morning. When Sherry is finished, Scott Thomas, who's over across the lake in Burlington, will speak. Scott is the Dean of Education and Social Services at the University of Vermont. Dean Thomas wrote a section in the book on CCR advisors. Scott is one of our country's great educational leaders, and Scott is recognized as a brilliant rural education practitioner and scholar. Following Scott, Governor Pataki will speak. And Governor Pataki is someone who really needs no introduction anywhere, and certainly needs no introduction in the state of New York. The governor, who's one of the finest leaders and people I've ever met, has been an ardent supporter of education in the North Country. Thank you, Governor, for being here this morning. Beth Rondandi is the heart and soul of Chapter 7. Beth, would you please raise your hand so people know who you are? Chapter 7 tells the story of how rural schools on the wrong side of the digital divide can successfully deliver virtual learning to students and families. Beth, who is a science teacher at Brighton Elementary School in Vermont's Northeast Kingdom, stepped up last spring to make sure that none of her students and none of their families were left behind. Because of Beth and her colleagues, people like Melinda, who's in the back of the room, because of them, kids in the Northeast Kingdom thrived. Beth, thank you. Brett McClellan, Brett, would you raise your hand, please? Brett exemplifies the best qualities of an up-and-coming educational leader. And I'm thrilled to report that Brett, who spent the last 2 years as a CFES fellow, has agreed to lead our North Country Brilliant Pathways program. Following our remarks, Beth and Brett and others of us here will be available to answer questions. Finally, I want to recognize John Rydell. John, would you raise your hand, please? John wrote Chapter 7. And I'm a little bit upset with John because most people are saying that Chapter 7 is the best chapter in the book. John tells the story about how rural schools can and are currently harnessing technology. The information that John provides in Chapter 7 is a gateway to the future, especially as we consider what the pandemic has done to forever change how kids learn and how teachers teach. John, thank you for being here and thank you for the extraordinary job you did with Chapter 7. Let me begin by telling you why I wrote Rural America's Pathways. CFES has a deep commitment to rural schools. We have a deep commitment to rural students and to rural communities. CFES obviously is based in a rural community, but that's not by chance. We're here because we want to make a statement as the only national organization that focuses on college and career readiness that's located in rural America. We care deeply about rural America. CFES pays attention to rural America, and we want others to pay attention to what's happening to young people and their families in small towns. After all, 20% of America's children live in rural communities and go to rural schools. So that's why I find it unconscionable that only 3% of America's philanthropic dollars go to rural schools and communities. It's the same old story. Rural America is forgotten. When I wrote the book, I saw firsthand how little research and scholarly work focuses on America's rural schools. The ratio is about 20 to 1. 20 articles about urban schools, one article about rural schools. And it's not that urban schools don't deserve it. It's time for us to wake up and recognize rural America and rural education. What's particularly difficult about being forgotten is that there's not enough help for rural America. We're talking about dollars, we're talking about people, we're talking about investment of role models. Compounding the situation is the fact that rural students already face so many challenges. Although rural kids are more likely to graduate from high school than their urban peers, rural students are less likely to attend college and far more likely to drop out once they get there. This is troubling for all sorts of reasons, not the least of which is the fact that jobs go to places where there are skilled, educated workers. Consider also these troubling facts. Rural kids are the likeliest group to grow up in poverty. Rural kids experience poor health outcomes. And rural kids are most likely to fall victim to alcohol and drugs. And even life expectancies for rural children is far less than for their urban peers. But despite these disturbing facts, there are many encouraging signs in rural schools and in small towns where those schools exist. Rural America's Pathways to College and Career is not a doom and gloom book. It's about hope and inspiration. It's about what a rural America can be. It's a call to action. The book captures the best practices that CFES has seen and the lessons we've learned over the last 30 years by working with 500 rural schools in 38 states across our country. The book also captures what I learned from 300 plus conversations with students, with educators in K-12 schools, educators in higher ed, colleges and universities, conversations with community members, conversations with people like Mitch St. Pierre, Sherry, you know him well, the chair of your school board, conversations with our young alumni, and I think of the group that I talked to from Crown Point Central School. I think of Kristen, who graduated from Middlebury College. I think of Emily, who graduated from Cornell. I think of Eric, who's about ready to graduate from the University of Rochester. I think of Drew, who graduated from SUNY Plattsburgh. Outstanding, outstanding young individuals. The book is also a guide. It's a guide to build better schools. The book is filled with strategies that students, families, and educators can use to make their schools better, to make their communities more economically viable, and to change life trajectories. 16 months ago, I drove down to Crown Point for one of my first book interviews. I met with Sherry and her principal, Tara Spaulding. I learned how Harvard and SUNY Albany were studying Crown Point because of their success in overcoming great odds. I asked Sherry and Tara that day. I asked them if they could lift up a struggling school in Mississippi or Oklahoma or Maine. They didn't blink. They didn't hesitate. They said, absolutely. That moment was an aha moment for me. I realized right then and there that we needed to transport what we learned to help other schools, students, and communities. I believe that the book can help rural schools transform themselves and, in so doing, lift up their communities. And that's why we decided to launch the North Country Brilliant Pathways Program. Sharing good ideas isn't enough. We need to turn great ideas into action and change destinies. That's why CFES is committed to raise $1.5 million to work with 20 schools in Northern New York and schools across the state of Vermont. Each school must complete a simple one-page application and submit it to us by May 14th. If a district has two schools or six schools, each one of those schools can apply. We'll select 20 schools based on community need and the school's commitment to change the status quo. We'll announce the names of the 20 schools on June 1st, and we'll officially launch the North Country Brilliant Pathways Program the next day. Our vision for the North Country Brilliant Pathways Program is to create a national model of excellence that will inspire and ultimately lift up not just 20 North Country schools, but hundreds of other schools across rural America. Let me turn the podium over right now to Sharon. Thank you, Sharon.
Thank you, Rick, for your kind words. And it's heartwarming to hear about our students and our success. Never have we heard some of those words before, so it's an awesome day to hear all those good things at one time. So good morning. As Rick said, my name is Sherry Brannick, and I'm the superintendent of the Crown Point Central School. I'm honored to have this opportunity to share with you the impact that partnering with College for Every Student for more than 20 years has had on our small rural district. The remarkable effects of our relationship has created an undeniable school culture, which has helped break the barriers of low socioeconomic status, broadened our horizons, and brought our students to previously unknown brilliant pathways. Our unending commitment to foster a kid-centered culture with values of trust, respect, and empathy are in the forefront of our success. The CFES model of core practices that includes mentoring through real-life firsthand experience, building essential skills of goal setting, teamwork, leadership, networking, perseverance, and agility, and creating pathways to college and career readiness are ingrained in our students and practiced daily at every level from pre-K to grade 12. Consistent messages and adherence to the mission and visions is of utmost importance. With support and their vast networks, CFES has hosted regular activities at Crown Point School. Our leadership team and CFES scholars plan activities and implement programs throughout the year. These include Panther mentors, senior buddies, college visits, college rally and career fair, alumni panels, essential schools work, skills work, and service projects, to name a few. Using strategies, values, and rigor, Crown Point was named a national model school for achieving exceptional results. With great pride for all we do together, we have also earned a designation as a CFES school of distinction for the past 10 years. Opportunities. This is what Rick Dalton, Tara Smith, and our CFES leadership teams have created for our students. Middlebury College Mentors, Aviation Day with Southwest Airlines, the DentaQuest program, creating STEM labs, and working with a CFES fellow are just some of the opportunities CFES has brought to us that have had a profound impact on our students. This partnership brings to rural schools what we cannot go get on our own. For that, we are forever grateful and look forward to what the future brings. Our successes with CFES programs have helped transform us from a low-performing, school in need of improvement district to one studied by the University of Albany and Harvard for beating the odds. We are a proud member of CFES and appreciate the perseverance of Rick Dalton for creating foundations for excellent schools so many years ago that has brought Crown Point Central School, a little school that could, to college and career readiness and beyond, a brilliant pathway for rural schools indeed. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Dean Scott Thomas over in Burlington. Scott, good morning, and thank you for being here with us.
Good morning, Rick. It's my honor and congratulations on the book. And if Karen thinks she's heard the end of the book, we know better, right? Fantastic effort, and it's just a delight to see it in print. And thank you for an opportunity to say a few words about our partnership and our role and the importance of this book and your work through CFES. Like many areas of the country, in Vermont, we tend to focus on what appears to be the unique social fabric of our rural educational character in the state. We, in the college and in our programs training educators, social workers, counselors, we emphasize place-based experiential approaches to our problems. We place the local and regional community at the heart of learning in our educational programming. And we bring immediate relevance to issues at the heart of community identity. These are all essential features of our approaches to understanding rural problems and trying to address some of the core drivers of the challenges that rural areas face. These place-based approaches play on the importance of the uniqueness of each community that we serve. We also recognize, though, that rurality is a common feature in our ever-increasingly connected international landscape. Acknowledging this, we've developed a wide-ranging network of international and domestic partners that help us reveal the many ways in which the value of local community and rural settings is actually a global phenomenon. CFES is one of the University of Vermont's most highly valued partners in this work. We approach our partnership with CFES with a deep commitment to reciprocity and learn from the activities, actions, programs, initiatives, and ideas that Rick and his colleagues at CFES have each day. It strengthens what we do at the University of Vermont. We're grateful that this partnership will enable more rural students to continue their education and expand their impact within their communities across their states. As the Dean of a College of Education and Social Services, I know firsthand that one of the surest ways of strengthening schools, families, and communities is through partnerships like the one that we have with CFES. We find that graduates in the field of education, social work, and counseling are more likely to return to their communities than graduates from other fields. The occupations tied to these fields are vital, durable, and central to the health and vitality of our country's rural character. I applaud Dr. Dalton for providing such a clear and compelling blueprint of rural America's pathways to college and career. While the contributions of his writings alone are impressive, what makes this all the more powerful is his taking the next step to help all of us move from blueprint to building through the North County Brilliant Pathways Initiative. Dr. Dalton and CFES are helping us understand the power of three core practices and cutting-edge strategies that are shared in rural America's pathways to colleges and careers. Rick, as you said earlier, turning great ideas into action and changing destiny is what we're all after together. The University of Vermont and the College of Education and Social Services are honored to have this important opportunity to participate in a national model of excellence in rural education success and improvement. I commend Rural America's pathways to college and career to you most highly, and I invite your interest and participation in the North County Brilliant Pathways Initiative. Thank you for the time, Rick, and congratulations on your book.
Thank you so much, Scott. Governor Pataki, again, thank you for being here this morning.
Thank you, Dr. Dalton, and thank you for having me here this morning. And let me say how excited I am about the CFES Brilliant Pathways opportunity that has been created for these 20 districts here in the North Country of New York and in Northern Vermont. You know, COVID-19 has changed everything. On a normal day today, when I was working earlier, I would have been working on the 24th floor of an office tower surrounded by tens of thousands of other people. Instead, today, I was working this morning in Essex, New York, a town of 600 people, and working every bit as effectively with my colleagues as I could have in New York. COVID-19 has changed everything in ways that are both challenging and that create opportunity. And I think the opportunities for North Country schools are enormous. Nothing is going to change more because of the COVID-19 experience than higher education, education in general. Parents today are grappling with what happens in the fall. What will our child do? Where should they go? How will they learn? And too often those parents and those children are saying, well, it's too dangerous. It's too risky for me to go off on a new path that's unfamiliar to my family and my community. CFES will show them that it's not too dangerous. And in fact, it is an opportunity of the lifetime. And as things change and we come out of the COVID-19 pandemic, you can look at it in two ways. You can say, this has been a horrible time and I don't know that we'll ever recover. Or you can say this is a time of change that has created enormous opportunities. And those opportunities in particular exist in my mind for rural education. Just think of what has happened here today. CFES, Brilliant Pathways, has outlined a program where 20 North Country school districts are going to have the chance to have significant expertise provided to them, their families, their students, their community, so they can choose the right path forward to having a better future. It is being led quite literally by the man who wrote the book. And the book has laid out that pathway. But the pathway does nothing unless we can convince those to walk that path, to choose that path to a brighter future and a better opportunity. Dr. Dalton in his comments said something I think was very important. Those 20 schools have to apply. They have to choose to be a part of this program. And they have to show a commitment to changing the status quo. This isn't just about enrolling people and signing things up and having another program. This is about changing lives, teaching essential skills, showing the pathway to opportunity, showing how a better career, a better future, and a better education can be achieved in every community, in every town and village throughout the North Country. So this, as I said, it's a unique opportunity at a unique time. Everything has changed. Are we going to seize that change to give people a better future? Or are we going to look at the future as something that is so uncertain that we're afraid to grasp the opportunity? So it's a limited time to have the opportunity to join this program. I'm proud to be a small part in helping as an advisor to make this a success. That is the commitment, not to have a program, but to have a success for those 20 school districts, and most importantly, the students and families who live in those communities. So Dr. Dalton, congratulations again. Thank you for what you have achieved with this. And this is just the beginning. And I look forward to being hopefully a part of this tremendous success for the students and families of the North Country. Thank you.
Media question part of the press conference. And just remind media again, Rick, the two people who were up here who didn't speak and what kinds of questions they could address.
We have Brett, we have Beth, and both of them have played in our plan a significant role in the work we do. They're on the ground and making it happen.
Brent is the director of the program, correct?
He will be the director
of the North Country program.
Yes.
Okay, good. So what I'm going to do is call on the media who are here in person to ask questions first. And I guess if you could come, if it's not too inconvenient, a little closer to the microphone so that people online can also hear you, that would be great. And whatever order you want to go in is fine with us. And then I'll get to the online folks.
Fred, I'm going to ask you to come up here with me.
And repeat the question.
So the question is, how do schools apply? And if you go to our website, you'll see a link to an application. There's a description, and of course, right over on that table,
we have a case statement of the North Country Brilliant Pathways program. And it outlines what we will provide schools, and then it outlines where the application is. I think we have some applications there as well, but Brett is taking the lead, and Brett is comes to us as a wonderful scholar at SUNY Plattsburgh, but he was also an All-American lacrosse player. So he understands recruiting schools. He understands winning and helping schools and students win. And we are so happy that you're the head of this program.
Thank you, Rick. Yeah, the application process is being circulated via email and phone call to all the schools that qualify for the program. In addition, like Rick said, it is on our website. The application is a very short three-question application. It's a Google form, so nothing has to be printed out. It is all can be submitted online right from that email. So, yeah, thank you. Yeah, I think Rick said it perfect. It's schools that are committed to changing the status quo. And through that application, that provides opportunity to express how you're going to change that status quo and how you're going to commit to that opportunity. The application talks about targeting specific students and how that will work, and then how the program will work in every school, because it's going to look different in an elementary school as it would in a middle or a high school, and all schools are offered to be part of the program. Thank you.
Other questions? I mean, just if anyone wants to talk about it, just like how special it is to have a kind of a new program like this in the North Country, kind of, you know, between Vermont and New York. I mean, this is huge in the sense that, you know, this gives, you know, students an opportunity to kind of, you know, pipeline to college. It's, you know, if anyone wants to talk about just how great it is to have the opportunity to be able to do this. Repeat the question.
Yeah, so this is a great opportunity for the North Country. The work with CFES has found itself all across the nation and even internationally. And Rick can speak to that. But there have been clustered schools. Our Gear Up grant provides great on-the-ground CFES work. That's actually where I am coming from as a CFES Gear Up fellow. But this gives an opportunity to expand what we do to more counties in the North Country, and then the entire state of Vermont that have the opportunity to learn what is the possibilities and what their pathway can become with our college and career exposure among mentoring and essential skills.
And where is that $1.5 million come from? Is that like a state grant from the state?
Over on my right is Karen Judge, who happens to be my wife, and she is the vice president for development. So you would be the better one to answer that question.
So the money, the grant, the $1.5 million that we intend to raise, we're already deep in the process, and we've identified a number of national, regional, and then local resources. And so it's a process. Development's a process, and we've got some commitments, but that's my job. That's what I do. So, you know, and as an organization, we are, you know, it's all hands on deck to make this happen. So we've done it before, we'll do it again.
And if need be, we have a reserve fund, and we will tap into that reserve fund. This program is going to happen, and we are going to raise that money. Over the last 30 years, we have raised close to $75 million, and we've been able to raise money because our program works. We have results that we can show funders, and we have results in terms of people. We look at the wonderful students from Crown Point and what they're doing in their lives. And that's what funders want to invest in. They want to invest in people and what's going to happen with young people. And we have a strategy that has evolved over 30 years, but it is all about, it's about mentoring, making sure that every student has a mentor, has a role model. It's about pathways, helping young people get on that path. As the governor said, there's a new world. So that path may look a little bit different, but it needs to involve post-secondary education. It may not be a four-year, it might be a two-year, it might be a certificate of value, but it must involve some sort of post-secondary study or training. And we also want our students as part of that pathway to understand what are the jobs, what does the workplace look like, and how do you take what you learn and meld it with where you're going in terms of earning the dollars that your family will need to survive and thrive. The third of our three practices is the essential skills. Again, Governor Pataki mentioned those skills, but we have found in our 30-year history that our most successful students are not those that necessarily have the highest grades or the highest test scores, but they have the essential skills. They have grit and perseverance. They know how to work as a team. They know how to set goals. They know how to be leaders, leaders of themselves, get themselves on that path and then help others get on the path. So those three practices are what we provide our scholars and what will be part of what we provide our schools, help them develop programs that, again, bring together those three practices. Three years. It's a three-year program. And it may go longer, but our commitment is to 3 years.
I know with remote learning, there's been more concern about kids falling behind and dropping off the radar. I imagine the season was burned or played long before the pandemic. How has the pandemic affected what you've been doing?
John, I'm going to. Tim, that's a great question. And 13 months ago, we did the. How has the pandemic sort of influenced how we deliver services and how CFES works? We did a major pivot 13 months ago, and we have developed a huge number of resources for our students, our educators, our families that we can deliver virtually. So John wrote, again, chapter 7, and he heads up our sort of digital content. And I want, John, you to come up here and talk a little bit about what you pulled together so eloquently in chapter 7.
Yeah, thanks. So it all changed, as you know, and we work in schools across the country in person. We had always been the model. Shifted everything online to virtual. We're in Texas, Florida, Atlanta, Boston, and allowed us to bring major speakers from the head coach of Miami Dolphins to, you know, we have people from partnerships that we work with Southwest Airlines that we're able to really work with these kids virtually, which never would have happened before, that we wouldn't have been able to bring to the schools. So in many ways, it's been an opportunity that's enhanced our mission, you know, tenfold, I think. And then once things change back, we still think it'll be a hybrid model where we can still bring these, particularly I would say mentors has been the biggest enhancement. We've had corporations very interested, KPMG, major corporations interested in having their employees work with students in their own communities. So a lot of CSR, corporate social responsibility, and we've been able to bring it to them through trainings, and then they work with our students. So it benefits everybody. And you know, those are just a few of the things we've been able to do. Brett McClellan put together a mentoring program with college athletes from Middlebury, Castleton. So all the area colleges, athletes looking to inspire young people, not just to play sports, but to persevere and all these kind of essential skills. Some people know them as soft skills, we call them essential skills. So it's just really enhanced everything. And I think, once things come around in the fall, we'll see how it goes, but I still think it'll be a hybrid and we're better for it.
Thank you, John.
One of the programs that we should mention, and Ron Ricks in the back of the room heads up this program, it's called the College and Career Readiness Advisor Program. And we believe that young people can't have enough role models and advisors to help them get down that pathway. It's not going to work if you just have one college counselor, guidance counselor, who's dealing with all sorts of other challenges. So one of our commitments is to train 5,000, whether they be educators, community leaders, business officers, bus drivers, cafeteria workers, family members, to become college and career readiness advisors. So each month we do a training, and the training involves a live virtual opening and a live virtual closing. And then there are 5 pre-recorded sessions that participants can take on their own. At the end of the training, participants receive a certificate from the University of Vermont, which is a big deal. And they get 10 professional development hours. We begin our April CCR training tomorrow at 2:00. We have almost 100 people signed up, and they are from Dublin, Ireland, all the way to Honolulu. So we span 10 time zones. And that's the silver lining of the pandemic, being able to reach more people. And I credit the team that I'm part of, those who lead me, for making this happen. Our team stepped up and figured out not only what are we going to do, how can we deliver our services, but how can we get better? Because the needs are greater, and we better be better at what we deliver. And the CCR advisor training that Ron leads is a prime example of that. Thank you, Ron, and thank you, team members, for what you've done, because what you've done in the last 13 months is extraordinary.
More questions? So we're going to go to the online portion now and start with April Barton at the Free Press.
Hi, yep, I have 2 questions. My first one is a pretty easy logistical one. Would this apply to next school year? I know you said they would be announced in June, which schools would be part of this program. Would this apply to the school year starting in fall 2021? Or would it not happen until all the fundraising has happened?
That's a good question. The program will launch this fall with the beginning of the school year. Like Rick said, the funds, if need be, that aren't raised immediately or at the beginning of the school year, will be able to provide the funding to get the program off the ground. And then for the 3 years, all schools chosen on June 1st will participate in the program.
Okay, great, thanks. And then my second question real quick, I don't see Dean Thomas still on the line, but I just wanted to know, what is the involvement with the University of Vermont? And I know that you did mention how they are certifying the college and career advisors, but is there something else specific that UVM is doing to participate in this program?
Rick, would you want to talk about how UVM has partnered with us?
The level and depth of our partnership with University of Vermont covers many years and thousands upon thousands of students. I should mention that a partnership that University of Vermont set up with a school in the Bronx that grew to 5 schools was led by and launched through College for Every Student. There are 400 young people from the Bronx who have graduated, have UVM degrees because of this partnership, including people who work now in our organization. The North Country program will involve certainly mentors from UVM, student athletes, faculty, staff, exposure to University of Vermont. One of the things that we do is get young people on college campuses. We know, for example, with our rural kids, that the further you live from a college or university, the less likely you are to attend college, to get a degree. So we do everything we can to get young people virtually and in person on college campuses and expose them to faculty, students, administrators, and that will be part of what I know UVM will contribute. There will be many, many ways that University of Vermont contributes in this North Country program. And we have had over our 30 years a spectacular relationship with UVM. And people like Dean Thomas have been incredible partners for us. And we thank them for that.
Great, thank you.
Kara Chapman with the Plattsburgh Press Republican.
Yes, thank you. I was looking at the program profile and I noticed that each of the participant schools is going to be paired with an urban school. And I was wondering if you could just talk more about what that partnership is going to entail, what the partner schools are going to get out of that.
Yeah, thank you. In rural communities, the lack of diversity that is found is something that contributes to early dropout college rates for students from rural communities. So the partnership that is going to provide the diversity that is not seen in these rural communities, and it's going to give insight and preparation into a college pathway that, you know, when you get on a college campus, you're finding often a very diverse community. And for rural students coming from a non-diverse, that's a big challenge for them. So this partnership is going to provide mentorship. You know, there's going to be peer-to-peer mentorship within this. There's also going to be just insight into how a day-to-day life differs and is also similar in an urban community compared to a rural community. And I think those insights are going to provide students and staff a great opportunity to learn more about, you know, the United States and college and career pathways.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Do we have the Addison Independent here? We know how to run these things because of listening to the governor's press conference. So I guess they're not here. Let's go to Pat Bradley at WAMC.
Hi, I'm a little bit curious about the funding for this. I'm curious why, I know that $1.5 million is a bit of a heavy haul, but you've mentioned the reserve funds and being able to tap into that. So why did you decide to cap it at $1.5 million and 20 schools? Why not go for more money and more schools since the need is so great?
But I want to thank you for joining our development committee, first of all. we saw 20 schools as doable. And it would be something that we could, where we could tap into our reserve fund without an issue. I fully expect that those numbers will increase. We're having conversations with school districts and funders from other parts of the country about our taking on rural schools in Georgia, Florida, Hawaii, and other places. So I fully expect that the 20 in the North Country will grow. But we wanted to not overpromise and underdeliver, but come up with a number that was unquestionably doable, where we could be successful in hitting those target numbers, those target dollars.
You mentioned talking to some of those other states. How unique is this program, you know, as you launch it then?
Well, this program is unique in that it's 20, and there are certain things that we can do here in the North Country because we have such strong partnerships with colleges and universities, businesses, and other entities. In other parts of the country, we may have some of those partners already, and we may have to find those partners. But the model will look the same. It is the three practices that we've talked about earlier, And how we apply those three practices depends in part on the particular culture and needs of a school.
And you mentioned that the schools need to apply fairly soon for this. What's the geographical limitations? Is it just North Country and Northern Vermont, or if say somebody from Southern Vermont or down in the Albany Schenectady region wanted to get involved, are they excluded from it?
The answer is no to that. So it's the entire state of Vermont, and it is the Adirondacks on up to the St. Lawrence Seaway, as far west as Herkimer County and as far south as the Tri-Cities. So it's a large geographic area, and we are being inclusive in terms of geography.
Thanks, Rick.
Thank you, Pat.
Courtney Kramer, channel 4422.
Hi there. I'm wondering, as the program gets underway this fall, what's the vision? Is it to, you know, up that college enrollment number? Can you just talk about a few specific goals once the program's underway?
Yeah. Great question. And the easiest answer for that is the program's initiative and their goal and vision aligns exactly with CFES mission and vision. We want to prepare schools, communities, and students to be college and career ready, to help those students find their own pathway. And we do that through the three core practices that we've spoke about: the college and career readiness, mentoring, and essential skills. I think when we talked about the shift to virtual and the hybrid, I think that's going to be a big part of our vision, really connecting students from all over the northeastern part of New York and Vermont with mentors or career and college pathways that are, you know, not only within their community, but outside their community and well as well, and things that they have yet to been exposed to, giving them the opportunity to be exposed there. And again, the ultimate goal is for those students to become college and career ready, find their own pathway towards secondary education, post-secondary education, sorry.
Thank you.
Tim McQuiston, Vermont Business Magazine.
Thank you, Jeff. Dr. Dalton, you had your opening remarks. First of all, good afternoon. In your opening remarks, you had some grim data on the prospect for students in rural areas. And it struck me, is this something that's been getting worse? You know, setting 2020 aside, of course, you know, over the last couple of generations, is, you know, our expectations as a society is that things get better. But it kind of sounds like things are getting worse in rural areas for these students.
Great question. The numbers have gotten worse in the last 20 years. 30 years ago, if we had talked about struggling students, all of us would have thought inner city. And that has, well, the problem is now we're still thinking, to many of us, urban, inner city. But challenges in urban communities have gotten more difficult. And it's a, you know, there are a couple of chapters about this, and there are all sorts of reasons. There's a distrust in many rural communities with higher education, and some of that has been brought on by colleges and universities themselves. Obviously costs are a huge issue. Think about young people going to four-year universities. Most kids have to take on loans, and a young person with a loan has to obviously pay off that loan. And it's difficult to return home if you live in a rural community and find a job today that will pay you enough that you can pay off your loan. There are all sorts of exceptions, I realize, so I'm talking in general terms. And just this one sort of exchange has caused the relationship between communities, education, certainly families in higher education to grow increasingly sour over the last 20, certainly 10 years. If you look at numbers or percentages of families that want their kids to get a four-year degree, you will see, if you look again at rural communities, that there are fewer families in these communities that want their kids to get a degree because of costs and other factors as well. Again, it's a large challenge. It's not any one thing, but yes, things have gotten worse for rural America. And that was one of the, that was an impetus certainly to write the book. All sorts of successes, inspirational people and activities, programs that are taking place in rural America that counter the general and the statistical move toward distrust of higher education and what that the attendant fallout from that.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else online we've missed? If not, is there anyone we've missed? No mystery media, okay. If there are no more questions, I think we're all set. And local people who are here, feel free to do more interviews. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.